Hey, everyone. Thank you. We're going to get started here in just a second. I wanted to start off by thanking everyone for coming to our Planning Commission and Economic Development Authority joint kickoff meeting for the comprehensive plan. We are really excited to go on this journey with all of you. Thank you to the public as well for being here. Again, this is a joint workshop for the boards. We will also be having public workshops, focus groups. Catherine's going to cover our public engagement plan later this during the presentation. Housekeeping items. One is please be careful of the AV cords that we have in the room. Don't want anyone tripping. There is a covered cord, but it's just please be aware of it as you walk through the back of the room. There are also restrooms back and to the right, and feel free to get up and move about as you need. We've got light refreshments on that counter over there, water, soda, and chips if you need anything. Again, thank you so much for coming, and I'm going to hand it off to the Berkeley group, starting with Catherine Redfern.
All right, can everyone hear me okay in the back? Perfect. Well, as Rachel said, my name is Catherine Redfern. I'm project manager with the Berkeley Group. With me today are Chris Musso, Benjamin Tripp, Darren Coffey's in the back getting a snack. We are the project team. We've partnered with the city of Lynchburg to update your comprehensive plan. This is the first in a series of workshops that we will have throughout the next year and a half. This is really tonight, this is the orientation and housekeeping for the process. What we'll cover today is the basics, essentially. What is a comprehensive plan, why it's important, why the city needs it, why we need to update it. We'll cover the process, a specific process that we've designed for the Lynchburg Tomorrow update process, the process that we're starting today. We'll review the specific approach to public engagement. So like Rachel said, today is a workshop for the Planning Commission and EDA. We will have specific public workshops and public engagement opportunities starting probably towards the end of September, and I'll talk about those a little bit later in the presentation. We'll also review some of the information gathering that we've done so far. We kicked off this project with staff in the spring, and since then we've been doing some work and some information gathering, so we'll just review some of what we've discovered so far. And then the last half of this meeting is really from hearing from you all, hearing from the commission, hearing from the EDA, what you all think is important. What are the key issues, opportunities, themes, things that we need to be thinking about as we're helping you all update this comprehensive plan? All right, so we'll start at the beginning. What is a comprehensive plan? Actually, before I start, I will say that for the Planning Commission and EDA, you all have a lot of materials in front of you right now. A lot of that information corresponds to the slides, what I'm going to be presenting. Any slide where there's an asterisk, I basically put that up there for my benefit to remind myself that there is a corresponding piece of printed information in front of you. For this first section, what is a comprehensive plan? There are two pieces of information. The first is this one page back and forth, that's the guide to comprehensive planning. This is a guide that the Berkeley Group puts together for all of our clients and communities that we work in. This is a quick, easy to understand flyer that explains what is a comprehensive plan. The working group should have received, we didn't print it because it's so very long, but the working group should have received a link to the Virginia chapter of the American Planning Association's toolkit, which is a document that they publish that covers in very technical detail what goes into a comprehensive plan and what are the tools that a locality has to update and implement their comprehensive plan. So that's if you're having trouble sleeping at night and you want to read a little bit more, that document is there for you and you should have received an electronic link to it. Okay. So those are the two pieces of information that correspond to these next few slides. So the question before us is, what is a comprehensive plan and why are we here? I like to think of a comprehensive plan as a community's roadmap for the future. It says, where do we want to be in 20 years and how are we going to get there? It is an official adopted public policy document that provides long-range direction for things such as land use, transportation, economic development, and housing. The plan itself describes the ideal future for a community and serves as a decision-making guide for your public officials and your staff, your planning commission, your city council, your city staff. That said, it is not regulation, not in the way a zoning ordinance is. It should provide the framework for those ordinances and for that regulation, but it is in itself, it does not directly regulate land or property within the city. The city's authority for updating the comprehensive plan comes directly from state code. The Code of Virginia mandates that every municipality, whether they're a county, a city, or a town, adopt and implement and update a comprehensive plan. It also mandates a lot of what goes into a comprehensive plan. All right, so what does the plan do? I think a comprehensive plan is as much about the process as it is the final document. It makes us ask the question, who are we as a community? What are the current conditions here? What are the issues and opportunities? What is important to us culturally? Understanding the answer to those questions, we can then establish a vision for where we want to be in the next 10, 15, 20 years. What do we want Lynchburg to look like in that time frame? What's important to us? What direction should the future take? And then most importantly, we determine how we're going to get there, right? What are the specific steps that we're going to take? What are those specific strategies that we are going to implement that are going to get us to that end vision? So one of the most important parts of a comprehensive plan is these implementable, actionable strategies, things that you can actually achieve. So, what goes into the plan? We work with the city to determine the exact format and content of the plan, but these are some of the basic elements that go into comprehensive plans. A vision, like we said, that describes the Lynchburg of the next 10, 15, 20 years, supported by a series of plan elements. Each of those plan elements will have a goal, a statement that says where we're trying to get related to that topic. And those goals are supported by a series of objectives and strategies. Those strategies are compiled into an implementation plan, and this goes into every one of our Berkeley group plans. This is really important, that those strategies come together in a work plan of sorts that has the specific action, responsible party, time frame, who's going to do it and when. And this becomes the checklist, the work plan for the city. So I mentioned plan elements. There's a lot that goes into a comprehensive plan. The name kind of gives it away, right? It's comprehensive. It looks at all the elements that make up the places that we live. And like I said, much of what goes into comprehensive plans in the state of Virginia is mandated by state code, but that does not mean that they are one size fits all. They are tailored to every community, the needs of that specific community. And part of that, the update process is working with you all to make sure that the topics that we're covering reflect the topics that you need, that are important to you, but that also meet state code requirements. All right, so why do we update comprehensive plans? Go through all this work, why do we update them? Well, just as communities are not static, their plans should not be static either. The priorities and physical landscape of places change, and plans should change to meet those needs. It's also important to note that updating the plan is required by state code, or reviewing the plan, I should say, is required by state code. Every 5 years, state code mandates that you look at your plan, you allow for any course corrections, and you update the plan as necessary. All right, so that's, in a nutshell, very quickly, high level, what a comprehensive plan is. Before I move on to the specific schedule and process for the Lynchburg Tomorrow update process, are there any questions about what a comprehensive plan is from the folks on the tables here? Any questions I can answer before we move forward? All right, so you're all comprehensive plan experts. You know exactly what goes into them. All right. So, okay. Asterisks. remind myself to remind you. There is a more detailed meeting schedule in your packet of materials. It looks like this. This shows the timeline for the project, and then the next few pages have each of these meetings that we've showed on the slide in more detail, who's going to be there, what the purpose of those meetings are, so you can read a little bit more about events, meetings, and the process on those pages. But the process for updating the comprehensive plan roughly breaks down into three phases. We are just at the beginning of phase one. We have completed the diagnostic analysis of the current comprehensive plan. We've completed some department interviews, and we've begun some baseline data collection. This first phase, plan kickoff, information gathering, and community engagement, those three fall under the first stage, are really about identifying the current conditions in the community, identifying key issues, key opportunities, planning needs. And we do that again by performing the diagnostic, looking at existing plans, talking to staff, data analysis, and then most importantly, this community engagement line item. We will also be engaging with City Council. We will be presenting at their retreat in November, and then following that up with some interviews to get their perspective on key issues and opportunities within the city. At the end of this information gathering and community input phase, we will have what we call a baseline conditions report that includes the results of the demographic and existing conditions analysis, as well as a summary of public engagement results. From there, we will move on to the drafting phase. This one here in green, I always think it's funny, it gets one little bullet, but it is the longest phase in the entire project. We will have 5 work sessions with Planning Commission during this drafting phase where we are presenting draft chapters to them, usually about 1 to 2 draft chapters per work session, getting their feedback, getting their input, getting their edits to those chapters. It's a lot of work, but it's a process that always results in a really great plan. So after we've made edits based on Planning Commission feedback, draft chapters, individual chapters get posted onto the project website, and I'll show you all the project website shortly, and there will be a public comment form that's available throughout the process where the public can read those draft chapters, leave comments, leave questions, leave edits. After we've drafted all the chapters, gotten feedback, we'll compile the plan, and then present it for public review as well as VDOT review. VDOT has a process, it's called the 729 review process. They'll review the final plan, provide feedback and edits to the plan, and then we will also present the plan at a public open house. Once we've gotten the feedback from the community, feedback from VDOT, we'll come back, meet with Planning Commission, meet with City Council, make any necessary changes to the plan before ushering it through the adoption process. And then it's on you all to implement the plan and to use the plan. Start to finish, this is at least a 20-month process. The first draft of the plan being available kind of late fall, early winter of 2024. I will say, not shown on this slide, our scope of work includes a diagnostic of the city's existing zoning map. Basically recommending potential amendments or changes based on the new comprehensive plan and new future land use map. And that'll happen towards the end of the refinement and adoption phase.
Curiously, is there a piece of this puzzle where the proposals or drafts or what have you are shared with surrounding counties or communities?
Yes, that's part of the review process at the end. Surrounding municipalities will get a chance to review the plan, as well as your PDC and other regional organizations.
I had another question that, yes, I may, if I missed it, I apologize. This is a 20-year living document, is it, if I understood correctly?
The planning horizon is 20 years,
20 years, and then every 5 years, there's a requirement that you revisit. Mm-hmm. So where are we within the timeline of the plan that's living right now?
Right.
In terms of the reviews for that plan. And is this a de novo, a new plan that we're evolving that then has to be juxtaposed with the existing plan on that 5-yearly basis?
Right. So the current comprehensive plan, 2014, where's my staff? Is it 2014? 2013-14. So this is a review and update. We're a little beyond the time frame for that. That happens in a lot of localities. We don't know quite yet whether this is just going to be an update or a full overhaul of the plan. An update meaning tweaking a few things here or there. I think we're probably going to be somewhere in between. Does that answer your question?
It does. And the sort of decision making in terms of whether or not it's a new plan or just an update is what? It comes out of this very process?
Yes, it comes out of the diagnostic, which we'll talk about. It comes out of public engagement. It comes out of the baseline data gathering that we're doing over the next few months. Other questions about the process? Okay. It's not your only opportunity for questions, by the way. Always happy to answer questions via email. All right, so we talked about the what and the when. Now we're going to talk about the who is involved in this process. And the short answer is as many people as possible in as many ways as possible. Comprehensive plan is a community plan. It should engage as many people as possible. And we'll walk through the public engagement plan in a little bit. But the point of this slide is just to show that the Berkeley Group, we're here just to facilitate. Like, we're here to do the heavy lifting of the researching, the drafting, but you all, this is your community and you are community experts. So we're gonna get broad feedback from the community at large. We're gonna rely on city staff and planning commission to help us synthesize that information and direct drafting so that we can put together a plan that your council can adopt and that can be usable and the right fit for the city of Lynchburg. What is your role as the Planning Commission, as the EDA who's joining us in the kickoff today? What is your role in this planning process? First and foremost, it is to encourage participation. You all are the ambassadors for this plan. So you are out there to make sure that people know about engagement opportunities, that know that the planning process is going on, and encourage them to participate in the survey and the workshops and the other things that we're going to talk about in a little bit. You're also our sounding board, and this is one of our first opportunities to hear from you all. And then throughout the process, during work sessions, specifically for the Planning Commission, you're our sounding board to make sure that we've interpreted things correctly, that we heard the community correctly, that we heard you correctly. So your job is to show up to those work sessions, to review the drafts that you'll get in advance, and be prepared to have a conversation with us and offer edits to make sure that we are crafting the best possible plan for the city. And then, of course, the Planning Commission will hold a public hearing where they recommend adoption of the plan before it goes to City Council. All right. Any other questions about that information before we move on to the public engagement plan? All right. Hearing none. Oops, too far. There we go. A public engagement plan is also within your packet of materials. Front page looks very much like this, but in black and white. All right, so this slide represents public engagement for the entire planning process. Obviously, community engagement is the backbone of any good planning document, and this process is no different. We've aimed to engage the community in as many ways as possible throughout all phases of the planning process, input and information gathering, drafting, and then review and refinement. The goals here are really to educate and inform the public. That is, get word out about the plan, get word out about opportunities to engage in the plan, and we do that through print advertisement, we'll do that through the website, which I'll show you in a minute, and we'll do it through integrating with the city's existing social media and online platforms. Second goal is listening and consulting, so hearing what the community has to say, hearing what you all have to say. And we do that through online engagement, we do that through the survey, the workshops, focus groups, and there's a constant dialogue commenting through the online comment forms. And then finally, receiving feedback. So making sure, like I said, that we heard you correctly, that we interpreted things correctly, and that we captured what you all think is important in the right way. And we'll do that through draft review, the public open house, and then eventually the public hearing process. I'm gonna walk through a few of these engagement strategies items in a little bit more detail. The first is the advertisement piece. how we're getting the word out about the plan. And we do that through print media, through flyers, guides, that can be distributed throughout the city. And the city's responsibility here is to make sure that those get to the right places in the city, that they get to the libraries, that they're in City Hall, that they're in schools, that they're in the other places where people are going to pick up these flyers and learn about the plan. It's also integrating that information into social media, like I mentioned. It's traditional media, so if you want to post an ad in the paper, radio, television station, making sure that they're picking those up. And again, while we're drafting material and providing that material to the city, it's your responsibility to make sure that it's getting to the right avenues for your community. And I will say we have been working with your communications and public engagements department. They've helped us with a lot of the branding, and we'll continue to work with them throughout this process to make sure that the message is consistent and it's getting to the right places. And if there are any other ways that you think we should be advertising or getting the word out, open to those suggestions as well. The main way that we are getting information, Vanna's gonna come over here and operate the website. The main way we're getting information out about the plan, this is the main repository for everything having to do with Lynchburg Tomorrow, is the dedicated project website. No? There is a website, I swear.
Does it like my face?
It's because it's set to not do that without it. So
gotcha.
Excuse me.
Yeah, questions, Paul?
I'm curious. You talk about us being experts as we live here and everything, and you're going to get a lot of feedback from people, some good ideas, some things we can't afford, but at some point, do you also, as the experts, give us guidance as you kind of missed these various opportunities for things that work in a Greenville or a
absolutely.
Stanton?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
We're the planning experts, and we have a lot of information. And so if we've missed something, we'll bring it up, and you know, maybe that won't work for Lynchburg, and that's your call to make, and we'll have a conversation about that along the line. There we go. No? Yes? We saw it for a brief moment. There it is. Okay. See, I told you it existed. We did make a website. All right. So the LynchburgTomorrow.com website is, like I said, the major repository for all things Lynchburg Tomorrow comprehensive plan. It's where you can go to find general information about comprehensive plans. It's where you can go to find information about engagement opportunities specific to this process. And then once we have draft documents available, it's where draft documents will be available for review. Can you scroll down so they can see the sign up? Yep. And so emails, one way we're getting the word out, email subscribers to the website will get news blasts when there's an engagement opportunity, when there's something noteworthy happening, the comprehensive plan. So we'll encourage anyone and everyone to sign up to make sure that they're getting the most up-to-date information. Get involved. This is where we have every opportunity to get involved in the plan. Once we have the survey finalized, it'll be posted here. Once we've set community workshop dates and locations, they will be posted here. And then we also have these additional engagement opportunities. They are the interactive map and the I Love Lynchburg campaign. Can you go to the I Love Lynchburg first? You might need to go up to the top to click it, Chris. Yeah, it's loading slowly. So one of the ways we're seeking to engage people is through this quick, fun, easy way where you can say, what do you love about the city of Lynchburg? We're planning for Lynchburg tomorrow. What do you love about Lynchburg today? And we'd like to include engagement opportunities like this because, like I said, they're fun, they're quick, they're easy. It's a cool way for kids to get involved. Kids are not going to fill out a survey. They're not going to come to an open house, but they might draw a picture of what they love most about Lynchburg today. They might just write one word, a quick sentence, or describe the place that they love most in the city. So this is just a really fun way to reach a different audience or to reach all audiences in the city in a way that's a little bit more fun. And once we start getting submittals, if you go to the More link, Chris, we'll actually have a carousel of revolving screens of all the pictures, all the photos, all the words, all the things that people have said that they love about Lynchburg. We also, in your packet of materials, we created a paper flyer. It's in there somewhere. But it's something that, you know, could be left at the library. Kids could pick it up. They could draw directly on the sheet. Their parents could take a picture of it, scan the QR code, upload it to the website. The other thing that we've done is this interactive map. It's not loading all the way, but it's an interactive map where you can drop a pin on a map of the city of Lynchburg. You can, we've got three categories, assets, opportunities, and perhaps issues. You can drop a pin, you can say, this is something I really love about the city, or hey, this is something that maybe we could improve in the city, or here's an intersection where I really wish there was a safer crosswalk. So it's a really cool way, interactive way, for us to get some very detailed, very specific, place-based information to inform the planning process. The document library, like I said, will be where we eventually have drafts available. There'll be an online comment form available. You can select which draft you're leaving a comment on. Leave us a question there. And then the FAQ is the last thing I want to show you. Just a list of frequently asked questions about comprehensive plans. Anything that anyone might wish to know, it's there. This one-page guide to comprehensive planning is there for folks to download, to read online. And then at the bottom, there's a list of other planning resources, current comprehensive plans, other planning documents that are pertinent to the planning process.
This sort of fits in with Sean's question earlier. We've got a number of master plans that have been done for different areas, and I'm just wondering if those kinds of things should be on that kind of a document library, simply
absolutely
to remind people that they're there and to figure out how we're going to incorporate all that, as well as, you know, maybe things from, as you pointed out earlier, from other cities that this is some other people have done, mm-hmm. just from an idea standpoint.
To your first question or first point, absolutely, there are some of the current planning documents are already linked to this website, and we will list others. And one of the first information gathering tasks that we're doing right now is reviewing all those documents to make sure that we know what plans are there, what plans are in process that inform and play a part in the comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan kind of lives up here over top all of those documents, so we need to make sure that it's acting as an umbrella and it's coordinating all the pieces. To your second point, which is basically about example documents or best practices, yes, absolutely. We look at them all the time for inspiration, and if there's ever, you know, a question or something that, well, we haven't seen that before, that's what we do. We go and look for other examples.
You know, I was just thinking from a public standpoint, because there's, I mean, to your point, I was in a lot of those meetings and I'm having a hard time remembering, you know, what the list would be of stuff that we've been through. And as you start to think about where you want to fill in gaps, mm-hmm. you know, just, I think it'd be helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll make note of that. Other questions about this or other things before we move on? Okay. Are we back to this working? Thank you. Okay. The second public engagement item is the draft survey or the survey, and there's a draft of the survey included in your packet. This is one of the most important public engagement tools that we use in our comprehensive planning process. It looks like this in your packet of materials. we've worked with the city staff, with Rachel and Tom, over the last month or so to review and develop this survey. Hopefully it'll be live in the next week or so. It'll be available both online and in print. And again, in print, it should be distributed throughout the city to all those locations we mentioned before. It'll be open for approximately 60 days. There is some wiggle room there, but we've just found that 60 days is really the ideal window. It's not too long, it's not too short, it's just the right amount of time to get as much feedback as you're going to get for a survey of this type. It also then gives us time to then download all the information, crunch the numbers, and figure out what the key issues are. The cool thing about the survey is that it can be taken anonymously. It can also be taken anytime you want to take the survey. So it's a great opportunity to get honest feedback and also to capture people who maybe aren't going to be comfortable showing up to a workshop, standing up in a workshop, or maybe for some reason just can't make one of those workshop times. Are there questions about the survey? The next major public engagement opportunity I want to talk about are our focus groups. We will be conducting 8 different focus groups throughout the public engagement phase, and this is where we invite business and industry and community professionals and experts to have a roundtable discussion on a specific topic, to really take a deep dive into that topic. The 8 identified topics are on the screen here. And also within your packet of materials are those same groups and then lists of potential Lynchburg-based organizations to invite underneath each of those topics. These groups are ideally no more than about 10 people. They really should be focused, and focused not just on a topic, but making sure that we can have a small group of people and have a productive conversation. We'll be, again, working with city staff over the next week to finalize these, to get the invites put together, and to invite those folks to those focus groups. What we'll probably wind up doing is having, say, 2 focus groups during the day and then a public workshop at night, just to be more efficient with everyone's time. When you all have time, if you've already reviewed the focus group lists, if you have ideas for other organizations that might want to include, happy to take those and to incorporate those into these groups. Oops, too far. All right, and last but not least are the hands-on public workshops. We have 4 public workshops as part of this process, and they will be held at different times and locations throughout the city, really to give people options and choice that's most convenient for them to participate in these workshops. The exact dates are to be determined yet, but we'll probably have some on weekday evenings as well as weekend afternoons, just to give people opportunities to participate. These workshops are open to the community at large. Anyone who wants to attend can. Each of them will be the same format. So same format, same questions asked at each workshop. And again, that's so that you could just come to one and participate and not have to worry about coming to another one. So again, being efficient with everyone's time. But that said, if there's someone who wants to come to all 4 workshops, happy to see you that many times as well. The way these usually work is we'll have a brief presentation, and here's Chris giving a presentation, followed by small group exercises where we'll do a SWOT style activity, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats, and then a hands-on mapping exercise. And the mapping exercises are usually thematic, so we'll have maybe a growth and development group, a transportation group, a community facilities and recreation group, for example. And once we get these dates set, we'll be working again with city staff to figure out exactly what those groups are, what the format is, and what the questions we're going to be asking during these workshops so that we make sure it's the right fit for the city. Any questions or thoughts about the public workshops? All right, so then I'm going to very briefly go over some of the data in gathering and work that we've done so far, but just one more break for questions about any of this. I know it's tons of information coming at you at once.
I'm just curious.
Yes, ma'am.
What kind of participation or results do you usually see in terms of participation in, like, the surveys? And does it just depend on the community?
It does just depend on the community. Yeah, absolutely. And different communities go about it different ways. So in Northampton County, for example, we had online surveys, paper surveys. We also translated the survey to Spanish, which really upped our participation rates. It's a very rural community, but we still had really great participation. I imagine in a city, we're going to have even higher participation rates, particularly for the in-person workshops, just because it's easier for people to get there. In rural communities where you've got to drive 45 minutes or more to get to a location, you're less likely to have people show up. But yeah, the short answer is it just depends on the community. Yes.
When you were discussing the groups that would get together, the mm-hmm. focus groups, who is tasked with building those groups or coming up with the people who will be involved?
Yep, so we worked with city staff to come up with this draft list, and that's included in your packet. But that said, we are open to ideas for other topics or for changes to the topics or groups that we're inviting. Other questions?
The only other thing I'd say is it seems like when we've done public stuff before, there have been pop-ups and stuff that they've had that have been really successful. I don't know if those are things that you guys have incorporated, thought about, or planned for this time or not.
Yeah, right now the scope just includes what we've shown you on the screen, but if there's a strong demand for pop-up events, tents or other, tables at community events, we can talk about that. I'm certainly very open to it. They do tend to be successful. Are we good for now? All right. I'm going to get through this next portion, which should be pretty quick, and then we can take a break, grab a sandwich, and then Benjamin's going to take over, and we'll do your portion where you tell us what you have to say. Okay. So, like I said, I'm just going to very briefly review some of the information collection we've worked on to date, and that takes really two forms. The comprehensive plan diagnostic analysis, that's an analysis of your current comprehensive plan, and then some city department interviews that we've conducted. I'll start with the diagnostic. This is a process that the Berkeley Group developed really to objectively analyze comprehensive plans, both for compliance with what's written in state code, as well as planning best practices. We analyzed the city's current comprehensive plan, and some of the shortcomings we found related to state code really fall into these four categories, and are those things that pretty much every plan that needs to be updated is going to be deficient in. So there was nothing wildly missing from your current comprehensive plan. It's just in need of a basic update. But the four areas here are first, to update population projections to make sure that we're planning for the people who are living here, to update transportation to make sure that we're meeting VDOT requirements and meeting any new projects included in VTrans and other studies that VDOT puts together, to address code-required topics, including not just housing. State code is updated annually, so this is kind of a moving target, but making sure that we are including those items in their most up-to-date form. And then finally, related to number one, making sure that growth areas are updated and reflected the population projections for the city. This report is included in your packet. It was printed out. It's this two-up. It is a very detailed technical report. There are matrices that go line by line, state code. Again, if you are having trouble sleeping, this would be the document for you. But these are the takeaways for the code compliance portion of the report. Questions about this portion, I should say. Okay, best practices. Berkeley Group uses the APA Sustaining Places document to analyze comprehensive plans compliance with current planning best practices. And we use the APA Sustaining Places document because the APA, the American Planning Association, is the professional organization for community planning. So these are the industry standards, right? And these go above and beyond just code requirements. But I will say that what we found through the analysis of the current comprehensive plan and these planning best practices are these four areas where the plan is most efficient are really those that align with code requirements. So expanding discussion of housing and housing choice and housing types, that's a requirement of state code. It's a best practice, it's a code requirement. So we're definitely going to make sure that we talk about that in the current comprehensive plan. Number two, including regional coordination. Someone had a question earlier about making sure that adjoining localities are going to review the plan. Absolutely, it's a best practice. We're going to do it here. Including an implementation matrix with actionable strategies. We talked about that. That's something that we do in every comprehensive plan. It's not just including strategies, but it's putting it together in that form where you have a time frame, where you have responsible parties, where applicable, you maybe even have a cost associated with it. And then finally, updating the plan structure for readability and use. Just making sure, you know, that pyramid we looked at earlier, that what's going into the comprehensive plan makes sense for the city of Lynchburg and that the parts are talking to each other, that it's a document that not just planning staff can use, but that EDA can use, that the public can use, that developers can use, that everyone can use to understand what is the vision for the Lynchburg of tomorrow. So that is a very high-level overview of the diagnostic. Are there questions about it? Okay. So just very briefly, because we are still actually in the process of conducting these department interviews, but just very briefly touch on them. There is also in your, there's a summary of interviews that we've conducted to date in your packet of materials. Looks like this. Part of the information gathering phase is reviewing plans and documents, but then also talking to city staff to make sure that we understand planning needs and from their perspective. We've completed 8 department head interviews, or department interviews, I should say, and we're looking to conduct at least 3 more. We've got a few more on the docket that we'll be looking to interview in the next month. And a lot of what we heard through those 8 interviews, really some consistent themes throughout them, that the city is in a great location geographically, wonderful natural assets, the river, the educational institutions are a real boon to the community, and that the city's got a lower cost of living than a lot of comparable cities, so how can we take advantage of that? Some of the issues we heard were financial constraints, and that's everywhere, unfortunately. But also staff retention. So how can we make sure that we're fully staffed so that we can do everything that we want to do within the comprehensive plan? And then the struggles of infrastructure, aging infrastructure, making sure that we're able to maintain and keep existing infrastructure and new infrastructure as well. So we'll continue to delve into these conversations with staff, and they'll be part of that. Those results will be part of the baseline conditions report that we'll generate towards the end of this fall, early winter, once public engagement is done, and refine those issues and opportunities and make sure that we've really captured from city's perspective their planning needs. But now it is time, it's time for lunch, and then we'll come back and we'll hear from you all what your issues and opportunities and themes are. Any questions? I know there will be more. All right. Well, then, if there aren't any other questions right now, I think grab a box lunch, and then Ben's going to pull us back together and lead us through a discussion.
Can you guys hear me okay? Nod, yes. How's lunch? Good? Let's give a big round of applause for staff for putting that together for you, please. Thank you. So this part of the exercise is, let me move this up a little bit so you guys can see me better there. In this part of the exercise, we have a variety of interactive questions. This is the part we said you need your cell phone for. So it's a lot of fun. And we want to have good interaction. So I encourage you guys to all talk and feel free to jump in. And I'll probably even walk around a little bit and talk with you as we go through it. But it wouldn't be planning without some public input and visioning, right? So anyway, we're really excited. It's a fun part of the exercise. Just by a quick show of hands, how many EDA people do we have here? Just so I can understand who the group is. Planning Commission, city staff, and members of the public? members of the public, we would love for you to participate in this, but we want to kind of keep the answers that we're looking at here for the Planning Commission and EDA, because it's their visioning session, but we definitely want to hear what you have to say. So we have some paper copies here that you can write out and you can kind of like fill it out. And when you're done with those, turn them in up here and we will keep and include that information as well. Is everybody ready to get started? All right. So first of all, cell phone. Our first question here is a calibration question. Can you read this? It says, how long have you lived in the city of Lynchburg? But what you're going to need to do with your phone, take your phone and go to either this web address. Can you read it? It's polev.com. polev.com/Berkeley Group 502. That's BerkeleyGroup502. You can also join by text if you need to, and use a QR code. Is everybody getting in?
Say that one more time.
Repeat it, please.
polev.com/Berkeley Group 502. It's easier to stand up and
How long have you lived in Lynchburg?
That's great, thanks. Is it on?
Yeah.
You hear me? Great. Okay, yeah, so some of you have already started. So you should see this screen, right, which has all the options on it. Has everybody been able to get in? So just press the button for how long you've lived in the city of Lynchburg or the Lynchburg area. You can do it. It's poll, P-O-L-L, dot E-V. Poll. You can come over here if you want, or just use the QR code. Yeah. Everyone is able to get in? Yes? Got it?
Super.
All right. This is why we include a calibration question. Correct. It will stay on this page until I move us forward, and your phone will automatically go to the next question. So the purpose of this is so that we can all ask a question. You can answer it anonymously. We see the results up here on the screen. And you're able to discuss what the results are. Marjette, you might try the QR code there. I'm just going to walk around, make sure everybody's in. You guys okay? Correct, 502. Paper copy here. Did you guys get in okay? Yes, yes, great. So I know we still have a couple of people who are getting in. Has everyone else answered the question? Yes? Yes? Well, you guys are a long-term group, aren't you? We've got lots of long-time residents here. You can see the G category, more than 25 years, is 67%, right? We've also got a pretty good decent contingent here in the 10 to 15. Is that what you expected? You guys know your own group. Are you in over here, sir? All right, super. All right, so the next couple of questions that we have are going to take your answers and turn them into a word cloud. So you'll see a question, and the next one is going to be, what does the city do well, okay? And it'll pop up here in a minute. Don't worry about that right now. But when you answer the question, try to use either like a few words or a phrase. And you can give multiple answers. I mean, if you have 10 things, do that. But try to not to use a sentence or something like that so we don't end up with like is, you know, as one of the the words in the cloud. Does that make sense? All right. Everybody ready to go on? What does the city do well? And your answers will populate up here as you enter them. You can type anything you want. Did everyone's phone go to the next question? Great. There you go. You can see everything coming up. See, and it changes every time as somebody enters new words. So we'll give it just a minute for everybody to put in, and then what we'd like to do is just discuss these. Look for themes for common phrases. And I'd like to hear from you all what you think about it. Does this make sense to you? As we're talking and working together here, you can see the bigger words, friendly, community, and recreation. The more the word is used, the bigger it gets. So as these themes emerge, do you as a group agree with them? So we'll give it just another moment for everybody to go ahead and finish up. Looks like it's holding still, so I guess that's everybody. All right, so let's talk about it, right? Like, what do we see here? Like I said before, you can see friendly, recreation, community, collect. Keeps moving around. But so recreation is probably the biggest word here, right? I mean, do you guys as a group feel like that's the case? Is recreation something that we do well? Yeah?
Yeah.
Tell me about it. What do we do well with it?
Well, we have an incredible incredible trail system, Blackwater Creek Trail, which is growing constantly. The river provides lots of recreation. The revitalization of downtown with just the plethora of restaurants and concerts and the academy. Our arts community has gotten very vibrant and grown a lot.
A few of these others have gotten bigger, like business. But before we move on to that, is there anyone else who wants to talk about recreation? No? Okay. How about the business community? Talk to me about business in Lynchburg.
Companies, yeah. Smaller businesses. It kind of covers a broad spectrum, which I think is great.
Okay.
So we have entrepreneurial up to huge corporations.
Great. So a diverse economy, you might say. Yeah, that came up in the director interviews as well. Anything about business conditions? Do you have industries that are doing really well, or industries that are maybe older and changing, facing change? Would you like to elaborate? No? It's all right.
To a large extent, we're in transition too, in the sense that certainly from the pandemic, a lot of the working patterns and conditions have changed. As was said earlier, we have a number of entrepreneurial businesses. We don't, which in contrast to other places I've lived, is really nice. But how are we going to take advantage and grow those things, I think, is a real question going forward. We have a lot of spaces that we've repurposed for business, and I think that'll continue. And how we manage that process to create spaces for both ends of the continuum, as mentioned earlier, entrepreneurial to larger businesses is going to be important. But that's something I think gives us a special flair and doesn't make us reliant on one or two industries like some other places I've lived that have turned into ghost towns after those industries left.
Yeah, absolutely. So, what do you think encourages that, or anybody else? What do you think encourages that entrepreneurial mindset, that startup type of there's new businesses?
Well, I mean, Marchette and the economic development have put in a number of programs to help take people who have ideas and help them turn them into businesses. They've done a lot of work and grown that program a lot. I think we also have a lot of people that I've dealt with have been people who have come out of some of the larger companies, the BWXTs, the Framatones, and started their own businesses to support that or whatever,
associated
spinoff kind of things. So, and I think we've managed to do that. I think one of the areas that I know has been discussed is in other places, the college environment has created a lab or an incentive program to roll off businesses, and indeed supported some of it as a tie-in with the educational situation. I don't know that we've taken advantage of that as much as we could. I think there's a lot of opportunity there.
Yeah.
Yeah, Tom, you can probably talk more to that than I can.
I'd just say I agree. I just say it's a very welcoming, business-friendly community, whether it's Marjette and Megan with Business Alliance, but also Tom back here as a manager of a business. It's easier, I think, here than a lot of other towns for a business to grow. And some of the hoops and other towns that you have to jump through to have a project completed to make something happen and get, you know, a move-in or certificate of occupancy, I think there's a friendliness and an interest in seeing the business succeed and not tying you up in red tape for months, really, to cause a project to go south in many ways.
Yeah, and that's really powerful. So you feel like it, just to expand on that, you feel like it is like the regulatory approval is easy and there's a mm-hmm. business-friendly climate. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great, yeah. So just looking at some of the others, we've got downtown. What about downtown? You do downtown well. What about it is good? Yeah, sure. Do you want the mic?
I lived here 13 years ago, and the administrative assistant set my wife up, and I had to stay in a hotel downtown. And at the time, I opted to go out towards the college because it seemed safer and just being new. I mean, I go downtown all the time now. It's safe. There are businesses like Dave's, and it's a happening place. I just think Kenzie mentioned arts and theater and everything down there. It just brings people here.
And a lot of that was spurred by the city itself with investment and other things that then brought in more businesses, and investment followed investment.
What kind of investment?
From the city?
Yes.
Years ago, the city was interested in trying to make downtown better. So some of the early buildings that were developed were supported by the city. The Bluff Walk was supported by the city. Craddock Terry was supported by the city. A lot of those, the Academy was supported by the city. So a lot of the core of what was there early was city supported.
Great.
And I'll just say firsthand, I decided to move a business downtown 7 years ago, Jefferson Street, right along the river. And the reason why I decided to do that, and that was arguably at more of a visible transitional time for downtown, it was because of the investments that the city had put in terms of their infrastructural redevelopment, if you will, them investing in their infrastructure, ensuring that the tools and utilities that we would need to succeed as a business were set in place. And, you know, we made that investment. They made that investment. We took a chance. And to see the city flourish with the resources and the people that are around us, that literally it's been amazing.
If I could ask you to follow up on it, just you talked about infrastructure there. What kind of infrastructure was that?
Well, previously, I believe it was a $250 million investment in infrastructure maybe 10 years ago or less.
Water and sewer.
Yeah, water and sewer, and we're continuing those projects even today.
Yeah.
But, I mean, these are pretty serious, not-so-sexy investments that needed to happen.
Help create that climate, right?
Yeah.
But also it looks, the spaces in terms of to gather and walk and things have also been invested.
Oh, it's totally different. I grew up in Lynchburg, and if you told me when I was graduating high school or even college that I was going to have multiple businesses downtown, honestly, I would have told you you're crazy.
That's great, though. And when you can keep somebody like you and have them invested in the community that way, you know, the product that you get out of that, the commitment that you have to the community is so great. You know, it's really, really wonderful. Yes, sir.
I would say I think it's a great tool as well for recruiting business that might want to move here.
Because
I think people come in here and they say, this is a really neat place. You know, I've run into people from out of town and they're like, this is pretty amazing. This is really different, and so that's a good thing. It's a great marketing point.
Definitely. What else up there jumps out at you guys?
We haven't talked about neighborhoods. I think one of the things that for me makes Lynchburg nice, and I've lived here for a while, is you do have a definite commitment and a community feeling about the neighborhoods. And I talked earlier about some plans that have come out, and their neighbors have gotten together and said, we can do better, and here's what we'd like to have happen. And a lot of times those programs are indeed funded and spearheaded by the neighborhoods. I think to tie into Tom's point, you know, when you start talking about people moving here, I think you want to move into a situation where you're going to have that kind of a neighborhood feel. You want to be part of something, and I think that's something Lynchburg does well.
Yeah, absolutely. Anybody else feel that way? Yeah? All right, what else? We'll do just a couple more, and then we'll move on to the next one. Yes, sir.
I would just add to Bob's point, I think he's right that the city does, in certain areas, put an emphasis on community and neighborhoods. And if you look at the current development in the city, where individual housing is being built, single-family housing, in the northern part of the city, and where large multi-use density is being built in the south central part of the city, you're going to see a different take on the neighborhood feel. So probably depends on who you talk to.
Do you find there are different residents in those areas? Attract different kinds of people?
Oh, certainly. Plus, the federal and state requirements require that certain people be placed in certain types of neighborhoods, which does contribute long-term. And then you add to the potential value of single-family neighborhoods with tree-lined streets and sidewalks and so forth versus dense apartment buildings and what those things contribute to a neighborhood over the long term, which one holds the value, which one has the American dream, which one brings people into the city,
sure.
Not out of necessity, but out of desire.
Great. Thank you. Any other ones you want to talk about from this one? A lot of these are really good. I mean, they're very positive things. You know, you can see friendly there. There's services, redevelopment, schools. Yeah, community. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. All right. Any other comments before we go on to the next one? All right. Well, great job. You guys are getting the hang of this. So here's the next one. What can the city improve on? And usually what we do, this is almost like a issues and opportunities type of exercise. So you kind of look at different sides of the coin. It's very similar to what we did with the directors. But it helps us to figure out, you know, where you guys are at, what are the parameters of the ideas. And it's also one of those great, you know, exercises that kind of gets the juices flowing, gets people talking. So is everyone's technology still working? It's very interesting watching it change as more and more answers are submitted, isn't it? Okay, have most people entered their responses, looks like it. So, I mean, if you look at this, you can see probably the biggest three or maybe four or five words. We've got housing, crime, schools. There's affordable here. I see zoning and river kind of coming in, and land even coming in as also RANs. I was going to say, is those of you who may have used affordable, does that go with housing? Okay, right. So that's good to know. Well, let's talk about that. Affordable housing. Do you feel like housing in the city is affordable now? Good question. Relatively affordable. Is it affordable for people who live here, given the prevailing wages? And you know, do you all hear from your citizens, from your neighbors, your constituents? Do you hear them say that they have trouble affording a house or affording an apartment?
I was a realtor for a long time, mm-hmm. and still am broke. I don't sell, but one of the things that, and I think Kenzie is, one of the things that you would see as a trend was the taxes in the city. when housing was more affordable, the difference between for a young family moving into the city versus moving to the county might be $150 a month just on taxes. You could buy more house in the county because they had half the tax rate than you could in the city with a higher tax rate. And what that does is it tends to often drive people, young families, to the counties, and it turns the houses in the city into rentals. Right now, the rental rate in the city is somewhere between 50 and 60% of all residents in the city are renters. Those are non-stakeholders in the city. Non-stakeholders. That's a serious issue that I think the city does need to face when looking at housing and development and zoning going forward. So.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Did you want to add something?
You know, affordable housing, I think that, you know, we're kind of built out. There's not a whole lot of vacant land left for us to build. So when you have, you know, new construction coming in and it's just,
after COVID, that the pricing is just way high. I mean, you're looking at $250 a square foot. So not, I don't know if that's necessarily Lynchburg's problem, you know, specific problem, but it is. I mean, it's impossible to buy a newly built home for less than, you know, $500,000, really.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Sure.
Marjet's here, she can quote the number for me. But I have a manufacturing workforce, you know, that their wage is not, and it's at a certain level, and 90% of them do not live in the city because they can't, you know, they can't afford to. So they live in Appomattox County or whatever.
These are employees.
Yeah, I have several employees who have been trying to find a house here for years, but their budget is $200,000. And yeah.
Well, and all the housing mostly going up in the south central part of the city that would typically be considered affordable is now apartment buildings.
Exactly.
All the new single family housing is being built in the northern part of the city, in the Boonesboro, Irvington Springs, Cheese Creek area.
So. Was there a comment over here? I feel like there. Yes, sir.
Off of what he said, I'm curious if you have data that can say whether or not we have a problem with too many rentals compared to other like-sized towns, because you see a lot of things being built, and then it seems like everyone has a friend who has a rental or a couple, and it's, you know, do we really have a housing number of house problem for the number of people that live here, or is it just that everybody wants to have a VRBO type thing and have extra income when interest rates were 2.5-3% is... Sure. Somewhat concerns me, and whether the city probably can't do anything about it, but you know, how do you try to protect that from happening more to becoming a rental city rather than an ownership city?
Well, we also have 5 colleges, and Liberty has grown at warp speed, and there are tons and tons and tons of kids here, and they're not buying houses, they're renting. And so all of the rentals that you see, you know, the flips downtown, I mean, the kids are everywhere. They're everywhere. So I personally think that rental number has a lot to do with the college population that Lynchburg has, which is really great. I mean, that has been, that's, but I understand what you're saying, and that there's got to be some kind of balance. But I do think the rentals are...
It's a valid point that you're making. Sorry, but the... Liberty is growing, but it's not the city's responsibility to provide housing for Liberty's excess students. Liberty has the land, and I'm a Liberty grad. I appreciate Liberty. Liberty has the land. They've got the money. If you don't believe that, drive towards Liberty. Up on the mountain, you're going to see a whole string of about $5 million of about 6 houses built up there, and they're cutting down the trees so they'll have views of the city. That's for faculty and staff up there. They do have the land, and if you go behind the mountain, they've got a whole bunch of new apartments back there and developments for the students. They can put it in. The county can absorb some of this. So it's a matter of priorities.
Thank you. Yes, sir?
Oh, I'm just going to actually echo what Sean was saying. You know, I've known enough people now that are buying the affordable houses because there's more of a return to rent them. And we even have neighborhoods that have been built that were affordable, like out on... out near the Home Depot in that area that actually were just bought up, and you know, people would just go in and buy them. It's like, I'm going to turn these into rentals. And so I don't think it matters where the house is built. It's pretty interesting. I had some in-laws that were looking at, you know, at a house in like in the Rivermont area, new construction, and they're like, wow, I feel like the prices have almost doubled since these were built. And they're like, they don't mind the taxes because they need the services that they don't have outside of the city. And so, I mean, I think we have good services for what we get, but I do wonder how we're going to deal with this whole rental issue. And that's going to be something that we're going to have to talk about, like how we use spaces that we have, you know, how we adapt some of the spaces that we have. And there have been rental units built on the Rivermont side of town. They're just a little different. They're a little bit, they're more creative. They're using spaces that were commercial. So that'll be something I'd like to see us find out how we can utilize those spaces better.
And it's sort of related to that, but I think it's a sort of a separate problem in that I'm amazed every time I look at the numbers, how old our housing inventory is. I'm just floored at the fact that so much of our available, you know, whether it be apartment or building or homes, were built before 1960. And how many were born before 1940?
Yeah.
It's just amazing. I don't know how Lynchburg compares to other similar cities on that, but that's always amazed me. And the second thing, which is sort of different but sort of the same, is I've always been amazed at the number of people who drive to Lynchburg for a job.
Yeah, 71%.
And I don't know if that number's going up or down, Marcia. I don't know where that is, but
we've always employed the county.
Right.
Thank you.
And it's just, but I think, but that changes. Those kinds of facts change the population that you have. I mean,
the complexion.
That's a better word for that.
Absolutely. Those in commuting, out commuting patterns. If you have more people coming in, you know, your place, you're somewhere in no one's bedroom community. Right.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, and it begs the question I was going to ask. As you've talked about the lack of affordable housing, what does affordable housing look like to you?
If you look at Virginia as a whole, it's been my impression that Lynchburg is moving farther and farther into Western Virginia, which I suppose is a bad term, but you're losing a lot of industrial growth. And so you're finding a lot of the things that would A, bring people, and B, pay for some of these things simply aren't happening at the same rate that they were before.
It's an interesting
trend. And I think that's, as you look at, you know, kind of how Lynchburg as part of the greater fabric plays, I think those issues have to do with what we're talking about as well.
Thank you. So what does it look like to you? Yes.
I think that question, the answer to that, isn't just an immediate answer. I think looking, it's a 10, 20, 30-year question. If what we're putting in places like Boonesboro are single family half million up houses with nice neighborhoods, in 50, 100 years, those may still be nice neighborhoods. But where you're putting density, urban density, places like Winters, places like Greenview, places like Town Crier, places like up on Timberlake, all along Timberlake, and we've addressed some more recent ones looking for conditional use permits on the Planning Commission. When you're putting more and more and more of these things in with a short-term view of meeting what's called affordable housing, there's no shortage of people buying these expensive houses at 8% interest rates. I don't know how they're getting these $3,000 a month mortgages, but they are, and there's no shortage of people buying these things. So affordable housing is a relative term. But when you're looking at what the city should be putting in, we need to think 30 years from now, what's an apartment complex going to look like? 50 years from now, it's going to be an urban jungle is what it is.
How do you hold value over time?
It will for the lien, you know, the lien holder and the land owner.
Right. Yeah. Just one more comment on this, and you know, just trying to keep moving with the questions, but it's a great discussion. Was there, did you have a comment, sir? Yes, sir.
You talk about affordable housing. I ride my bike in the mornings, and if you go from here, mm-hmm. Kemper Street, to the river, there's a heck of a lot of houses, some of the prettiest houses that may be 100 years old. But a lot of people can't afford to keep them painted and keep them out of decay. So there's also, whether there's federal rehabilitation programs or, you know, sometimes just being nosy, you look at the tax assessment on it and you say, you know, they got that house for a dollar and, you know, now it's worth whatever. But are there opportunities to try to help people stay in their homes and not have the roof fall in and create, yeah, there's just a ton of houses up and down 11th, 12th, 5th, 6th Street that I didn't, you know, feel like every day I'd take a wrong turn, I may see another row of houses I never knew existed.
But there's opportunity to there.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. Okay, so we talked about that. Let's talk just briefly about crime and then schools, and then we'll move on to our next one. So to talk to me about crime. You say this is something that the city needs to improve on. Any exam? Yeah, go ahead.
Just gotten worse over the last, I would say, 5 years probably. I mean, I grew up here and it just wasn't there, you know, until recent, you know, more recent, and I, you know, I'm not sure if that's a nationwide thing, you know, if it's just following a trend, but I definitely feel that there is way more incidents and schools are going on lockdown consistently, and that's just happening over and over again, and you know, it's something needs to be done.
So I was going to ask, what kind of crimes?
What kind?
Yes, ma'am.
There have been more and more shootings in certain neighborhoods and murders. I mean, you know, people have died, and it just, I used to say, I mean, like, no, there's never a murderer here, you know, and now, you know, I get asked those questions as a real estate agent, and it's getting trickier to answer.
Yeah, thank you. I wanted to know if you meant like property crimes or other types.
Yeah, no, so, not necessarily.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think for people who read the paper, there was just a gunfire up here at the corner of Wadsworth and Memorial, so that's a block away, yesterday at 5:30. And I don't think, you know, I think if we look around communities, I actually don't think Lynchburg's doing badly as compared to some other communities around us. But I think this becomes a kind of a cultural or heart issue, you know, where, you know, the police can only do so much, but, you know, nationally our police forces are, I think, looked at more as enemies. And I, you know, I think it's a tough one that we have to do as a community. We can't expect a department or staff to fix this. And I don't know how we do that. I'm glad we don't work with that in land use as much.
But it is a tricky question, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. One more on crime.
Okay. I don't know if this thing works. I would say that from my perspective, crime hasn't risen that much. I don't know. I haven't read the statistics, but it's moved around. I've lived here for over 40 years, and I lived in a neighborhood for about 40 years, and there's gunshot fire every night. It was either gunshots or firecrackers, but somebody was setting off something just about every night, and we got used to it. We just slept through it, and I don't think that's there anymore. This was in the Garland Hill neighborhood around Federal Street, and there was always a lot of crime and a lot of drug sales and prostitution and all kinds of stuff back in the 80s and 70s and 80s in that area, and now none of that is there. And so it's probably moved somewhere else, but from what I can see, it's less than it was. So.
Thank you. Moving on just briefly to schools here. Talk to me about schools. Yes, sir.
I want to sort of endorse what I just heard. What has happened is that my wife and I have been interested in this area. We're attracted from Northern Virginia down here, specifically for the low crime index and the plethora of old houses, especially along Federal Street, 11th Street, those kinds of things. We found it really much better than seven years ago, in that area anyway. As a matter of fact, we were looking for a big house and the low crime index. And that's what attracted us from Northern Virginia. We've been here now 3 years, or two and a half or so, and it's been as expected. What can I say? Maybe that's not long enough to get a larger sort of comprehensive idea of what the whole city is, but I can speak specifically to that area as a great improvement over the last 7 years or so.
It's a great perspective. Thank you for sharing that. Anything else on crime before we move on? All right, talk to me a little bit about schools, something that we can improve on. Sorry? How much time do we have? Just briefly, I'm going to try to go on to the next question here in the next few minutes. High level.
I think schools have taken a little bit of a turn. I mean, I went to the public schools, my kids did, and they were always, our Lynchburg City schools were kind of our shining, you know, shining light back in the day, and people would come from all over because we had these amazing public schools. And I think it's taken a turn. Again, is it a trend, you know, that's not just specific to Lynchburg? I'm not saying it that it you know, not necessarily isn't, but we've definitely struggled with schools, and it has, I believe that people that are making a choice between sending their kids to Lynchburg City or possibly moving to Bedford County, or even, you know, Campbell or Amherst, you know, are choosing county schools over city schools because they're not quite as great as they used to be.
So what has changed?
What has changed?
Yeah. Or what's an issue now?
Parenting?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's really hard to know.
Yeah.
But I do know this. I know the populations in the school are down. And I also know that back in the 80s and early 90s, the schools were mentioned regularly, like EDA, in recruiting businesses. And I think, like, if someone just read the paper, they wouldn't feel that that's true. And I don't think they're used as a recruiting tool like they used to be. But it's a tough environment.
You know, I do think that with the internet and with mm-hmm. the people being able to go on and look at the awareness. Schools and their rankings, the rankings at Lynchburg City have, yeah. when you're comparing them to the counties, are different because in the city you've got a different population, you've got a different economic, you know, you've got this, you just got a more variety. And so the even though the education's not necessarily different, those rankings are, you know, there's a lower graduation rate in the city than there is the county, and all of that. People look at that, and they just assume.
And you're talking about, you know, like when you, if you go to Zillow or something
correct.
Like that,
yeah,
and you
yeah,
see
yeah,
a
yeah.
score from.
Yeah. yeah. So those, I mean, I think that has probably contributed to more of a flow of people going into the counties.
Sure. Thank you.
And layer on top of that.
Yes, sir.
Layer on top of that, the maintenance of the schools, the infrastructure, the situation of our schools, and then you've got teachers that are leaving because the pay in counties is better. And so there's a whole myriad of issues there as well.
So I heard there are several things. I heard retention and pay for teachers. You mentioned infrastructure. Do you mean like the buildings themselves,
yeah. Yeah.
the,
yeah.
you know, being updated in good repair, maintenance?
Yeah, I mean, there's shining stars out in the county, right? These beautiful centers of technology and great places to learn. And then, frankly, if you look at some of our buildings, it's just, yeah.
Age, yeah, okay. Thank you. Did you have a comment?
I just think This goes into some of the stuff we talked about earlier with affordable housing. It's a multifactorial problem. It's, you know, we talked about parenting, we talked about curriculum. You know, the reality is, I don't know what we have, 7 elementary schools, 5 of them weren't accredited last year. I mean, that's a hard thing.
Yeah.
I mean, to your point, I don't know how, as a parent, I'm supposed to look at that. There's a lot of issues. There's been a huge growth in homeschool because people have just gotten fed up and they pull their kids out. I've been surprised at how much private school enrollment has increased, you know, in spite of the higher cost. So, you know, it's obviously something that's important to people, but we have not gotten a good handle on managing all those different factors. I'm not trying to overcomplicate it. I just think it's just a complicated issue, and there's no one lever you can hit that's going to solve a problem.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Kind of along the lines of what Bob was talking about, my mother-in-law taught Lynchburg schools for quite a while. One of the things that frustrated her over time was the change in thinking in public schools. And we all have stories and memories about when we went to school, but now, if say you're at EC Glass or one of these other schools, you have a child who doesn't want to be in class that day, they can act up, and there's a button in the class that the teacher or the student can hit, which comes and retrieves a counselor to take that kid out to some get some counselor, get some rest, or whatever they want to do. And having years and years ago, I subbed in the schools, and of course, you know how it is when you're a sub, you know, you learn how to handle things. But I found out what a lot of teachers talk about is the thinking has changed. You can't discipline the kids. And they spend, teachers spend a lot of their time. You have to assign the homework. These kids are doing 2-3 hours of homework at night, most nights, because you can't teach in the classroom. And to finish up with what Bob was saying, it's got to be related in some way. Most of the city schools, a lot of them, can't get accredited. In fact, if you go up to Heritage Elementary School up on Timberlake, they've got a sign in nice colorful letter that says accredited, like it's a big victory that they've got right out in front of the school. You know, we don't have accredited schools. And there's a reason, you know, who are we hiring? What is our thinking? You know, what are our schools doing, you know, toward the, and it's not a recent thing. This has been going on a long time. I don't know the last time they were accredited.
Interesting. Thank you. That kind of leads actually into our next question for everybody here. This is, what are the key issues facing the city today? So, you know, you've talked about schools and crime. Those might be on this list as well. But think about it, you know, whereas the other one was what can you improve on? These may be social issues. They may be things, you know, within your community that need to be changed. When they pop up, this one is not a word cloud. We're going to get these little icons here with the words that you put in. We'll come back and talk about some of them, just like we did with the others, but we can also sort of star them and make them bigger, too. Yes, sir. The question is, what are the key issues facing the city today? It should be on your phone if you're looking at that as well. Yes, sir. Do you mind? So the more you input here, they slip off the page. So we're going to go back, and I'll kind of read them out to you. We can talk about them when we're done here. You may have to disconnect this little clicker thing. Yeah, pull that out. It shouldn't turn that off. It'll stay on the screen. This is just my control.
Yeah.
Sorry. Question will show up on your phone. I'm not sure that the answers will. Your answers will show up on the phone. So just to read through some of these, and we'll talk about them as we're trying to see if we can get all the rest of them. We see schools, crime. We talked about those, right? We have economic development, hunger, homelessness, infrastructure, business growth, funding, poverty. And this will continue to populate. There's infrastructure again. Are there any of these that you want to talk about a little further? We could talk about, say, homelessness. Any thoughts on homelessness?
talking. It sounds like home. Too many people know me. They'll start throwing things here in a minute. You know, it's something that a lot of cities are struggling with, and for a lot of the same reasons. But in Lynchburg specifically, from what I know, we've gone through, for lack of a better phrase, a purge of a lot of the housing and facilities where a lot of people who needed extra assistance to find that any way you want had a place to live. And for whatever reason, those places have closed, and so a lot of those people have ended up with no place to go.
Yeah. Related to affordability.
Right, and we there have been a number of programs to mainstream people with disabilities, and you know, as long as they get their medication on time, they have some supervision, it's fine.
Sure.
If they don't, then they end up, you know, a lot of these people end up being homeless, and they end up, and we simply don't have the slots to put them in.
Other thoughts on homelessness? How about industrial development?
Well, we're landlocked.
Yes, sir.
We're landlocked in the
Correct.
City. And we don't have flat land, for one problem. Moving dirt costs a lot of money.
Yes.
So we are, I call it lack of developmental land.
Lack of developable land?
Yeah.
And that has to do with the terrain. You feel like a lot of the easy to develop land has been already developed?
Yep.
How about the relationship with Liberty? Or any of the other colleges, relationship with colleges in general, maybe it's a better way to put that. You bring a lot of people here, right?
That might reflect a little bit on what you were saying, Bob. Like if you look at Virginia Tech and their relationship with Blacksburg and Montgomery County, you know, it's nice to see large institutions contribute back, not giving money, but actually contributing brain power and good things for their students, and bringing that into the community in the form of maybe industrial development or job creation,
sure.
New technology, things like that.
All right. Any others that you've seen pop up here that you want to talk about? We'll go on to the next question. All right. Oh, I don't have my clicker plugged in. You'll have to click for me. Thank you. All right, our next question here, what opportunities should the city take advantage of? We have this one and one more. Last one's kind of fun. And these will pop up just the same way. We can talk about them. We've got nuclear growth, young workforce, housing redevelopment. You missed it before. The question is, what opportunities should the city take advantage of? Before it starts to slide off the page, let's talk about nuclear growth, nuclear industry.
I mean, as I said earlier, we've picked up a lot of entrepreneurs from that business. Mm-hmm. We've got a lot of support businesses for that business. Quick political plug. I think that's where the power of the future is. I mean, so I think, you know, it's got an opportunity for us to be part of a growth industry.
Sure.
Going forward. Again, I think that's an opportunity, you know, to really coordinate a lot of resources. I think the colleges are a good one, and that's a good thing. That's a good way for them to be involved in some of the ways that you talked about, Tom, in developing jobs and developing opportunities within the, in the city. I think that's a good central hub for those kinds of things.
Do you know if any of the colleges have like a nuclear engineering program? I don't off the top of my head.
Yeah. CBC.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
I know that the, I think it's interesting, you know, Campbell County has a lot of the nuclear work is done out there, and those are actually sites that are federally licensed, so it's not like they're going to go anywhere. So, you know, it, I mean, it's not like our old metal industry that we had where factories said, we're just going to close up. These have value, so I think that's a neat
thing. Really is probably going to define what you're talking about looks like. Because one, you're not getting any nuclear plants approved. It takes 10 years. You get a design approved through the NRC in the United States right now. They're not building any nuclear plants. Right. We are the sole fuel supplier for the U.S. Navy right now. And there is no other place they're getting it anymore. They closed the only other plant down. I can't remember the name of it, but it was a Crystal River or something. They closed it down. So we're it. So if you want to talk about nuclear growth and professional, yeah, that could happen in the colleges. Here, we could produce students, but it's really going to be driven by BWXT and Riva. You know, outside that, I'm not, I don't know, how much do you think that we could do to do that? It's a good idea. You know?
Well, EC Glass has a program that coordinates with those companies, and they do internships, and and it's all set up for them to take jobs.
Maybe education-driven.
Well, no, I mean, they'll give them
to
jobs.
Get into that.
Yeah.
Huh?
After college. But it's setting up that path.
Yeah, that's a good program.
So what other things do we see up here that you believe are opportunities the city should take advantage of? Can you read it? You want me to read them again?
The river? It's there and you can get on it, but it's not easy. And it's not easy to go downtown unless you go to Percival's Island. And with the train tracks and some businesses, it may never be.
Right.
But it sounds like from last economic development meeting there was some potential plans that have been discussed for years, but it just feels like it's a resource that it's there, but it's more in the back of your mind than this riverfront walk or something that you know is restaurants right there on it, but you can't get over there really.
I have an employee who actually talks about that, and he is always asking me, so you're on the planning commission, work on getting a boat ramp. I'm like, well, there's one across the river. He said, I want one in Lynchburg. And there might even be one, but I think part of it is people don't know how to access it, and the banks are steep.
Didn't they talk about that 20 years ago?
Yeah, it's been an ongoing, this has been an ongoing thing.
So access to the river.
Yeah, like.
Particularly with the railroad.
I do think it's interesting that we tout the river as one of our beautiful assets, but to access it is very difficult. It's not equitable. It doesn't always feel like an asset.
It's really interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really interesting. It doesn't always feel like an asset.
Well, like Lynchburg's always been a big bring your own place. I mean, growing up here, I mean, sorry, you'd be saying, it's a bring your own fun place. I mean, the reality is you've got, you know, we grew up fishing the river. You made your own adventure.
Right.
The mountains are close. There were places to hike, not always places that had, you know, trails that didn't have poison ivy in the middle of it. Don't ask me how I know. But we've got all kinds of stuff around. And to what Dave said, to create the access to make those things easier. And things are in place. I mean, I'm a stupid example, but there's a business in town that does fly fishing stuff. I can't tell you the number of times I go in that store and they go, well, we have a fly tying class. Somebody went down the river, lost all the flies they tied, came in and bought new stuff and went right back down there. So, I mean, we've got, we certainly could improve it. Those are things, I think Dave captured it. We've got to make it feel like more of an asset by creating spaces that people can get to it. And looking at it ain't getting it done.
Right. Thank you. Yeah. All right. What else up here? Water resources kind of goes with that. River recreation.
That's it. Water resources. Just as Lynchburg talks about the water quality, And I know we used to have a fair amount of food production, and water quality is important for that. You know, we had a time when breweries were like going up everywhere, and we didn't have any, but we had the best water. You know, so it would be interesting to see how we could utilize our water resources and the water department more, actually as a way to create jobs in one way or another.
Thank you for clarifying, because I thought you meant the river. You mean
Quality
of the
actually, yeah,
municipal
the quality
water.
Of the water infrastructure.
Yeah,
yeah,
great. Thank you. It's an excellent point. It is a big attraction for industry. Others on the list? All right. Well, let's go to our last slide here. Now, this one's a little bit different. Oh, that's right. Thank you. The question is, what specific goals or projects would you like to see the city focus on? Now, you'll notice when you look at it on your phone that you have the ability to answer the question, but you can also up and downvote projects, the other responses, right? Does that make sense? It's kind of like Reddit. So you've got the first one, you would enter what you think is a goal or project, and you can enter more of them, as many as you want, and then click submit, and then underneath it, you can see the other responses, and you're going to click the thumbs up to upvote it, or the thumbs down if you don't like that one. So you can see these guys changing place a little bit here, right? Now, you can vote on other people's suggestions. We've got river, urban density. These all have just one thumbs up. There we go. Add to our trail connectivity is in the lead with three thumbs up. Right underneath it is the river in downtown with two. Got land and buildings for economic development making a late play here. See everyone still looking at their phones. I'll give you just a couple more minutes here. I'm going to give you about another 15 or 20 seconds and then phones down. You guys enjoying these with your phone? They're kind of fun, right? Yeah. All right. So let's all put the phones down and take a look here. I just want to discuss them. And you can see what's risen to the top here. Actually, it's interesting. They're not all exactly in order. But
For five, with five thumbs up, we have build outdoor amphitheater at Riverfront Park. Actually, let me start with the sixes, excuse me. We have trail connectivity regionally, add to our trail connectivity. Those have six thumbs up. Then for the fives, we have build outdoor amphitheater at Riverfront Park. We have education. We have land and buildings for economic development. We have one, four thumbs up, which is housing at all levels. And then we also have improved public schools and affordable housing. Does that sound like how you would prioritize those? Do we want to talk about any of them? Tell me a little bit about trail connectivity. That one's the got the most thumbs up. Yes, sir.
I'll be the first one. Interesting. I do something maybe a little unusual. I like to mountain bike, and I bike with some guys pretty regularly. And there are some great trails around here. I mean, you know, Peavine, Arcadia. You got Carvin's Cove and Roanoke, and
like single track type stuff.
Single track type stuff.
Awesome.
Liberty's got about 60 miles of trails up there, with about everything up there, from the easy to double or single Black Diamond, probably. And all that being said, Roanoke used to hate mountain bikers. It just wanted them to get off our trails, get off our mountains. And somewhere about 10 years ago, they changed their thinking. And I don't know what it was, but they started putting in more trails and, attracting a lot of people. And now they've got a thriving mountain biking tourism coming in there. We've got the resource. And I know there are guys in my group, some of them are trail builders, and they're very good. And they work with Bedford County. And they've talked about linking up some of the trails from the Appalachian, you know, the trail up there, and some others around the area that you could actually just continuously ride, travel camping. So there are opportunities there, you know, for Lynchburg to bring people in. And Margette nodding her head back there, to me, it's a great idea.
Well, and I'm sure she can expand on this, but there are many opportunities for tourism and, you know, for conferences to bring folks here. What was the name of your group, if you don't mind me asking?
The mountain bike group?
Yeah.
It's not a group.
Okay.
There are groups like GLOCK, Greater Lynchburg, Outdoor something, Community, whatever. That's Blackwater Bike Shop, and then Bikes Unlimited downtown. They're expanding some things going on. There's more than you might think, a lot of road riders, but there's quite a few trail riders around too.
Yeah,
and you know, and even down North Carolina's got a great network down in Pisgah down there.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. So,
thank you. Are there comments on trails?
Can I?
Yeah. Oh, so, yeah. Thank you.
So, you know, I think that the mountain biking side, there's great stuff. You know, Liberty has the trails are pretty incredible amount of mileage in Lynchburg, but also, you know, I think that I've talked to people who've come here and they've actually come here from Charlottesville or Farmville, and they're like, just to ride on Blackwater Creek Trail. And I think there's a lot of opportunity to build out that type of trail that allows people to get to work. And I think that's something that younger people really like. They like to actually not have to drive to work as much, like we can ride our bike to work. So I think there's a lot of opportunity with some abandoned rail space and other green spaces that we could do more of that type of thing as well, and get, you know, someone who lives downtown that could ride to Liberty if they wanted without having to ride on the expressway.
So what do you feel like is the barrier to that? Is it the backbone of the system and building that out, or is it like the connectivity?
Well, I think, right?
Yeah, well, I think it's probably like willingness to invest in it, and probably a group of people who come together and say this is going to be a project. Because, you know, I think there's grants and things like that for that kind of stuff, but the city has a lot of other burdens as well.
Sure.
And so some people might look at that as, hey, this is like a, you know, pie in the sky idea, but it's actually a great tool for recruiting businesses and for making people healthier. And so I think it takes more than just, you know, saying this is going to be a goal. It has to be more people involved.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
I know.
Yes, ma'am.
The Parks and Rec already has a plan to build out the trail system some more, but I mean, it goes. Right now, it goes across Percival's Island. It goes all the way to the end, and you get into Amherst County, and then you're sort of in a no man's land where you can't get off the trail for a while. And then it just ends after a while. But the plans were to go all the way to Appomattox. What I would like to see it do would be to loop back and go, and this is Amherst's problem, not Lynchburg's, but loop back to their park that they have. And
And it would be really nice if you could get across the bridge to do it. Mm-hmm. And that's in our plan, is to put bike lanes and walking lanes on the John Lynch Bridge, so you can get across the bridge there. But once you go across, you just have to come back.
Same way.
The other plan that should have happened and was thought of probably 70, 60 years ago when they built the Carter Glass Bridge, they put underneath it the perfect support for a pedestrian bridge under the vehicular bridge, but I've been told that's probably never going to happen. So.
Interesting. Yes, sir. I'll take one more on this.
Just a quick piggyback, and maybe this can be tabled for another time, but on the idea of recreational opportunities here in Lynchburg. You know, I sit on the CVU board, and we leverage a soccer facility out in, where is CVU Fields? Rustburg, thank you. And then we have FYAA, and anyway, all of these places require all this massive amounts of land. And in order to keep this land maintained, it requires massive amounts of volunteers or, you know, obviously, you know, dollars to support. And anyway, it does seem to me that there's an opportunity for Lynchburg to kind of figure out a way to become a connected hub, if you will, for these disparate organizations, maybe to find a way for them to collectively come together and create a stronger recreational space. I don't know if it exists, you know, within city boundaries or not, mm-hmm. but somehow find a way to let Lynchburg play a major or a bigger hand in that.
That's a great comment. I mean, what does that look like to you? Like if you can imagine it.
I don't really know the answer to that, frankly, but I do feel the pain that an organization like CVU feels. And as a parent with kids on these teams, seeing the level of play that our kids go through due to the fields that they play on and the coaching that they have, and you go to another state and you go on these massive facilities with restrooms and concessions and beautiful fields, and you know, of course, the grass is sometimes always greener, but it just feels like, and I could be making this up, I don't think so, it just feels like there's an opportunity for us to get a better, stronger hand in that space.
Yeah, thank you. Just because we're running short on time to talk about a couple of these other goals and projects. Any of the others, the outdoor amphitheater, we have education and land and buildings for economic development. Any comments, discussion on those?
I think you heard education concerns with the schools. I mean, we're talking about a lot of niceties, but I think there's needs that the community has to focus on that sounds like more from the earlier conversations of making sure our schools are back to where we used to have them and be proud of them, and issues we haven't talked about with poverty, and I don't know how this is maybe not the group that ever fixes that, but I just feel like, you know, for someone who comes and sits in the back of the room here, there's maybe things we've somewhat glaringly missed.
Oh, yeah, there always are. And that's one of the reasons we have discussion, other opportunities for input. But you're absolutely right. Other goals or projects you see on this list? No? Yes, sir.
Ask a question. You moved here from somewhere else. And I think that's fascinating because I've run across people all the time, you know, that we looked around, we came to Lynchburg. Based on looking at this kind of a list, what strikes you as something that, you know, that either would be or attractive to you coming to Lynchburg, or something that we ought to put on the list that's not up there?
That's a good question. I'm looking at it from 7-8 years ago. What it was then compared to the development of the downtown since, the refurbishment of the big thing, the kind of effort that's been put forth over the 7 or 8 years. I'm saying I'm new, a newbie, 3 years, 2.5 years, whatever. So for me, it's a different kind of look, and I hark back to cities that I know from not having lived there, but watched the development. The basic problem, it seems, with cities of this type, this size, today seem to be drug related. I think the genesis of the demise of most of the cities, of course, is the rise and increase of drugs. Take Charleston, South Carolina, for instance, which was a, I'm talking now 15, 20 years ago, a wannabe city, if you will. They had the traction of the military there, with, or the Navy specifically, with the tourism and that kind of thing. But they had a big drug problem. They went to somewhere out the Midwest, I'm thinking Chicago, brought in a crack guy to head the police department. They specified drugs as their main impediment to development. This guy came in, put all of the resources of the police force in the drug area. He focused and kept that hammered down. In about 4 years, they no longer had a drug problem.
And so you feel like?
The way was open for the development of tourism. They had the Spoleto Art Festival there at that time. But it's a different city. Totally different city. Access improved. The, on the map of the South, when you're talking South Carolina, they struck a real bargain there. The guy is no longer there. He was recruited by other cities to come in and do the same kinds of things. So often, I think, we don't focus or don't want to admit what's really wrong at the base. And until that's done, I don't think you can build reliably on something that's a little loose at the base, let's put it that way. And so I have put in one of my things based on the experience of Charleston, South Carolina. I'm sure you can look it up. That that's one of the things that we were speaking of. Whether there's a drug increase from what it was 8-10 years ago. And I'm not putting this forth, and I may be a thing for a later discussion, but I'm just putting that out as something to think about.
Thank you. That helps.
Thank you. This is a great discussion. That takes us to the end here. I just want to tell you all how much I appreciate it, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. It's always really great to get that kind of thinking and discussion going. So I appreciate you all sticking with me. Give yourselves a big round of applause. Thank you. I'm going to hand it back over here for our closing slides.
Thank you. That was a lot of fun watching you guys have fun answer those questions. Just very, very briefly, next steps on our end, we'll finalize the website, we'll finalize the survey and get that published. In conjunction with the city, we'll be scheduling those public workshops, finalizing the focus groups. I know there were some comments about who's coming to those focus groups, so we do welcome any and all feedback, changes, additions to these public engagement items. And then, of course, the big lift is advertising all those public engagement events, making sure we get people out there. Looking forward to the next one. This is my email. You can reach me here. Of course, if you all have ideas, email Rachel, email Tom, and we will see you all next time. Thank you all so much.